Okay, good morning, colleagues. My presentation today is basically looking at how we are going to engage students in assessment through the use of rubrics. And as Susan has already mentioned, we have been part of the Train the Trainer STAR group, and this was one of our assignments given through that training process, that we had to go back to our discipline and try out how rubrics could improve the learning process in students, especially the quality of student learning. Now, I put this sign here at the bottom just to show that this year is the International Year of Chemistry, and it's in honor for those chemists who have been doing so much for this world. And we had a very successful conference last week which ended, but unfortunately I was not able to attend all of that, but I heard it was quite good. Okay, I think all of us here who are involved in the learning teaching process, you always find that from the teacher's point of view, we try to do as much as we can so that the quality of students actually increases. And I think everyone here is trying all the methods they think is good for them. Generally, if you look at this particular diagram that I have shown here in picture, most of us are standing here. And from the teacher's point of view, we try to design our content. From there, we design that what sort of objective this course will tend to take. From that, we design our learning outcomes. And I think under the STAR program, we all have been going through this development of learning outcomes. And we have been using the Bloom's taxonomy to decide on the level of verbs. And from there, we go on to decide what sort of teaching activities we have to undertake, give to the students, and towards the end, we set tests or assignments. No matter how well we do in this process, the students will never ever come to the course and start looking at the learning outcome. They will always come from the assessment point of view. They come in the different direction. They will first look at what or how many examinations are there, what is the percentage, how many assignments are there. Based on that, then they will start doing the learning activities. And then they will come to know what the learning outcomes are. So, to be practical here, we don't allow the students this part. Right? We don't give the students the freedom to know what sort of assessment they will be doing or they should be doing. We decide. So we have to be careful, so when we are designing this part, we have to keep in mind what the students will think. So when we go from this direction, we also should go back to see that if the student is looking from the assessment point of view, will my learning objectives or learning outcomes will be achieved? What is a learning outcome? I think my colleague yesterday gave a very good definition, and a lot of definitions were given. I think this one I found it very, very easy for students to understand, and probably us as well. Learning outcomes are statements of what a student should know, understand, or be able to do at the end of the learning activity. So once the learning outcome has been sorted out, we do the summative assessment. And what we have noticed is that most of the time this formative assessment, which is the given instruction that how the assessment needs to be done, is missing. We only tell you that these are the content, you have to study this, this, this. Towards the end, we are going to have a final examination, which will cover all the content that we have got. Now, what sort of answers, how we want it, what we are going to develop in the student is mostly missing here. We only give instruction. So the use of rubrics becomes very handy. If you look back here, if you know that the students are learning from this direction, then the assessment that we are giving, which is this part here, we need to give them instruction what is to be done there. And this is where rubric becomes a very important tool to improve the student learning. What is rubrics? A rubric is a statement, is an assessment tool for communicating expectations of quality. Rubrics support student self-reflection and self-assessment as well as communication between assessor and assessee. Now when you are given, like most practices where the test paper has been returned to the student, then we have to write comments that these are the areas you lost mark. If the rubric is provided, the student should be able to know from that rubric where they have actually lost the mark. Quite transparent. A rubric is a set of criteria and standards typically linked to learning objectives that is used to assess or communicate about a product. And I've given an example here which I have used in one of my assessments. Criteria is what you are going to actually assess the student on. And this excellent milestone and benchmark is basically the standard. Benchmark is at the lowest level. Milestone is somewhere in between. And excellent is the very top quality that you would expect in your student in that level. Now, when we give out these rubrics, rubrics are generally thought to promote more consistent grading and to develop self-evaluation skills in students as they monitor their performance relative to the rubric. The last part here is actually like a developmental part that is happening in the student learning ability, the quality that is changing. You don't expect a student to come in a course and start behaving as an excellent student right from the beginning. We have to develop the student's ability, the quality, from week 1 right up to week 15. Now, the university has already decided on the 7 institutional outcomes. One is specific citizenship, teamwork, ethics, professionalism, creativity and innovation, communication and critical thinking. The ones in the red are supposed to be your discipline-specific outcomes. And in chemistry, we have decided there should be 2. One is to formulate, conduct and prepare a quality report on a scientific research project in chemistry. And the second one is to solve chemistry-related problems. In science, there are two streams for a particular course. One is to look at the theoretical part where they attend lectures and answer questions. The other half is to do the experiment. Now, what we think is that when we do the experiment, we might get very good data. But if you are not able to express that data in a good quality report, that data becomes useless because no one will be interested in it. So we need to develop this part, and this is the outcome that I took in which I was going to apply my rubrics. Now, in the second part where we need to solve chemistry-related problems, why I did not choose that, we have 2 topic tests, one in week 7 and one in week 14. And the assignment that we were given was to apply the rubric in one of these outcomes and to see how the rubric was actually developing the students' learning. So this was good, because it started in week 42 and it will end in week 14. And they do it every week. Okay, we also decided that with the 7 institutional outcomes that have come in, we developed 7 rubrics, 7 institutional rubrics to test these outcomes. For this one, we had to go and develop our own rubric. That is for the discipline-specific one. And as I said, I chose this one, so I developed a rubric that was specifically looking at the left part, the experimental part. Now, this is an example of one of the rubrics that is an institutional one to test one of the institutional outcomes, and that is creativity. The criteria here is originality, research skills, problem solving, and integrating traditional. And we have seen that there is a level or standard, and it's given that the benchmark is here, milestone academic excellence. Now, just to make it clear, in one of these training, we were told the benchmark is supposed to be the excellent for degree 1. Milestone is supposed to be the excellent for degree 2. And academic excellence is supposed to be the excellent for the graduate. So when you look at the graduate attribute, it shows there is a progressional increase, that by the end of the third year, the student should be falling in this category. So in my course, which was a second year chemistry course, I took the milestone section to be my excellent region. And then I had to go back and develop a benchstone and a milestone for that course. Now, if you look at creativity, not all the criteria could be used in my assessment. So, in the application for this rubric, as I had, I think I indicated this while ago, we looked at in the lab because that was a progressional one that is going from week 2 to week 3, and we also found out that students in this area were actually lacking to write good reports. So we were trying to look at how we could increase the style of writing, the level of writing in students could increase. In writing up this rubric for my course, the first thing I did was to identify the important criteria that was that will be used to assess the students' lab reports. Then I tried to see that the criteria that I have actually decided on, did it match with any of the institutional rubrics? And then the third one was, I looked at the second year, I mean the milestone from the institutional rubric to make it my excellent in my rubric, and the rubric that I should develop, it should be both developmental and summative. That means it needs to show that how students could improve. And second thing is that using that rubric, I should be able to assess the student's ability to learn. I hope it can be seen clearly. There were four criteria that I chose. One is the presentation, that is how the student is going to write the rubric, and it comes from the communication institutional rubric, which is in one of the generic courses that was given by our colleague Rajati yesterday, how to write English stuff. The second one was from the UU100, use of ICT. So you can see here is that the generic courses, they introduce the students all the concepts of doing writing and ICT. And then actually one day that course is supposed to do is to get the students into the boat and let the disciplined people tell the student how to row that boat. So this is what we have basically done here. Then we looked at critical thinking, which was again one of the institutional rubric of critical thinking. And the final one again was calculation with involved innovation and creativity. And these were the criteria that I was introduced. And the marks were allocated as follows. In the benchmark, 6 to 5, in the milestone, 7.5 to 6.5, and in the excellent, it was 10 to 10.8. What we were basically doing here was developing the institutional outcome for the specific discipline. The second one was developing discipline-specific outcomes. It's not that we are just only trying to improve the generic courses outcome, but also the one that we think is important in our outcome. And there should be a process of improvement in the students. Okay, now I show you the evidence. The lab reports were marked according to the rubrics, and if you look at the first triangle, that is in the rectangle, we got P for presentation, ICT for using the ICT program, critical thinking and problem solving. We were all given the mark out of 10 because according to the rubrics, whether it was falling between milestone, excellent or benchmark, the marks were out of 40 and then calculated to be out of 10%, so that it could be loaded onto Moodle. When I look at the lab marks for these students over a 6-week period, if you look Individually, you can expect the student may do up and down in one of the two reports. But if you look at the overall average class, it started from 6.8, which was right at the benchmark level when they entered. But towards the end of week 6, we can say that they are achieving excellent grade. And this is how, because what happens is that when they look at their report, they go back and check it with the rubric. Okay, next one, I'll improve myself. And you can see there is a progressional increase. This is one lab report which is from a theory student. It is all written in pen. No typing is done because they are not following rubrics. If you look at the one that is given through the rubrics, you can see the quality of the writing has actually improved. The use of ICT, the use of referencing, the way they are structuring the report, there is a flow. Anything that they are observing, it's all written. Although this part is not included in the rubric, but it develops the student, you know, the style of writing. Because what they actually do is that they go to the library and they start looking up other reports as well, those published ones, and try to incorporate that style into the chemistry lab report. Now, if you compare that with one that is given for the third year student, which is basically not following any rubrics, but still that person is writing up the introduction, if you look at them, I wouldn't say this is bad, it's just a fault on our part. We have not given the students what they should be doing while they are writing up the report. The other part that is important is that when we are giving the rubrics to the students, it makes sure that the rubrics should be comparable. That means if you are giving a rubric to a student who is doing a second year course, remember this course, the student is not doing just only one second year course. They are doing two or three courses in the same year. So the rubric should be comparable. Compare the one that I gave and compare the one that is given here. Both are second year. So the student gets confused whether they should be writing a report according to a marking scheme like this, or we use a rubric where we are actually developing the student's skills in writing. So, I mean, from our point of view, it might think that we have given the student the criteria, but when you look at the holistic picture, we need to be consistent so that the students don't get confused. So finally, the importance of rubric in assessment, as I showed using the small assessment that we did for my course, and you can see it does change. Second one is that you can see how the generic courses which have developed their own criteria was actually incorporated into the discipline specific rubrics. And third is that we need to have a comparable rubric at the same level. And so during the curriculum mapping, you should be able to see that a 100 level course, a 200 level course, and the 300 level course should show a progressional rubrics. Thank you.